I guess we'll get started now at the Italian-American Town Hall, speaking out. Respect is a two-way street, something that one constantly has to work on. Before, I just want to do a brief, we will have two panel discussions. One will be chaired by Dean Anthony, who is here, Anthony Tamburri, and the other one will be chaired by Judge Russo. We'll be going into the topics of who we are, how we became who we are, and actually, while becoming, what did we become? And where do we go from here? Here with us tonight, we also have Richard Vitere, who produced a movie called Where Are We Now? The Italian American Today, which was funded by the Russos and won Best Short Documentary at the Ridgewood International Film Festival. Richard himself won Best Director for a Short Documentary from the Cutting Room International Film Festival. I come here as someone who's been involved in the Italian-American community for some time. I was the president of the National Council of Columbia Associations, and I'm currently have been for years now a board member of the Italian-American Writers Association. I recently was interviewed online by Trubi Cavaliero, who is the publisher, editor of Primo magazine. You can see that interview on www.primoonline.com. It covers, I think, pretty much what I see as what we need to do and what we're trying to do. One of the things that I see is that when you talk Italian Americans to young people, in many cases, you get like puzzled looks. About a year ago, I was speaking to a young lady who was a banquet manager at the Roosevelt Hotel, and she had an Italian name. So I said to her, "Oh, that's an Italian name. You're Italian." And she gave me like a double take. And then she said, "Oh, yes, my grandfather." So that's something that I believe, as we publicize these issues, we have to find a way to reach them. It's not their grandfathers that are Italian Americans, yes, but also they are. And in my opinion, as the society is now undergoing, some would say, a sea change, which occurs every so many decades or even more than decades, it's important to stand up so that the world understands who you are, not just yourself. We have a history here, going back 200 years, when the largest lynching of people who were in jail but had already been acquitted occurred in New Orleans, when I think it was around 12 or 14 Italians, I believe they were Sicilians, were executed. Essentially because they were Sicilians or Italians, and did not recognize, since family was the thing for them, they treated blacks who were not part of their family the same as they treated southern whites who were not part of their family. Well, this was anathema in New Orleans 200 years ago, and they paid for that. We could go on to Sacco and Vanzetti, we could go on to the Massachusetts textile strikes in the 30s, where there was a woman whose head was scalped by a machine that was not properly covered. She was Italian, triggered the strike. Years later, when the strike was over, her son was interviewed and he was informed about the strike, which was basically suppressed. And he said, oh, now I understand why every so often, although my mother was a great worker, she got laid off and then rehired because they were still punishing her for the strike. That was in an article written by black man Stanley Crouch, who was writing for the Village Voice at the time. So we have a history here. I'm a first generation, so I feel it very strongly. My parents were both born in Italy. My father came here when he was 20, right after the First World War, and brought me up essentially as an Italian in Italy, which I dealt with as I went to school here. So I have a strong feeling for it. As I could take myself back to the 60s, when I don't recognize, at that time, I did not recognize any Italian American heroes other than baseball players or musicians, which was fine. They were great, but they were not the type of social heroes that sort of other groups seem to generate. And we are now continuing to discuss how we deal with the fact that the word must get out there, that Italians are American, but we are Italian, even though we socialized and were assimilated, I believe, not in the public square. Possibly the last immigrant group that was not assimilated in the public square. In the public square, you were not to be Italian. I can remember being told by my mother, don't comb your hair that way, you look too Italian. And I said, but Ma, isn't that what I am? But we assimilated at home, in our communities. You had the cooperativas, you had the little clubs that were all Italian. But in the public square, the idea was to not be Italian. That's not the case now. The current groups get all upset even if you discuss assimilation, which was an issue a couple of months ago. And there was also a little press that went around. There was an Italian fellow from California someplace. I don't recall his name. I thought that his comment was, why are we even getting upset? After all, we're all recognized as white now, aren't we? We are Italian. And let's keep pushing that thought and figure out ways to get to the young people and to get to the press interested in this. I'm now going to call on Dr. Tamburri, who will begin with the first panel.
Thank you. Good evening, buonasera. And that's about what you'll get from me as far as multilingual. These are a few thoughts that have a title, which is Cultural Philanthropy, a Private Affair. And my hope is to create some conversation around that whole subject and hopefully encourage those who can to do. So in his groundbreaking essay, Breaking the Silence, Strategic Imperatives for Italian-American Culture, Robert Viscusi championed an articulation of history that includes a collective purpose, collective being the operative word. While much progress has been made on numerous issues, I believe that many Italian-American associations still seem to continue to work in a vacuum, moving forward alone on issues, whereas were more groups to work in unison, the Italian-American population at large would benefit, thus encountering greater success and bringing forth a variety of projects that would contribute to what we might call an Italian-American agenda. While it is, what is or what should be that rallying point around which Italian-Americans might find some sense of commonality? Indeed, both African-Americans and Jewish-Americans have, respectively, their one issue, as tragic as it may be, that coheres the group. I have in mind, of course, slavery and its dreadful sister of outright discrimination that has resulted from it for the former. Two millennia of diasporic existence and the horrific 20th century Holocaust for the latter. What then can we identify as that cohesive force for Italian Americans? Can we look to something like immigration, that time span from 1880 to 1924, those 44 years that have now become an historical marker for contemporary Italian Americans? There may indeed also be specific tragedies that come to mind, the 1891 New Orleans lynching, for which we hold the dubious distinction of having been victims of the largest single group lynching. One might even underscore historical discrimination dating back to the 19th century and culminating to date in something like The Sopranos or perhaps even Everyone Loves Raymond. Though valid points of discussion, these last two examples do not constitute in an encompassing manner that one issue that can unite the Italian-American population in the same way in which other groups cohere. We might thus ponder what is that all-encompassing issue that unites, for instance, Latinos. In addition to a strong sense of belonging they may have with regard to their cultures, it may very well be the migratory experience, a sense of not belonging to the host country 100% that coheres Latinos. Surely I do not want to be naive. I do not want to be naive in thinking that Latinos from many and all Latin American countries have an equal sense of allegiance to what some of us refer to as the old country. Nor do I want to imply that all Latinos have an automatic sense of belonging to the group composed of Latinos as categorized in the United States. Nevertheless, we would not err in perceiving a certain sense of commonality that has its origins in the migratory experience, insofar as they perceive themselves as outsiders and, as such, hold on to their culture of origins. The combination of difference and cultural specificity, based in part on the migratory experience, surely figures as a cohering agent. A similar formula might prove valid for Italian Americans. Immigration and its century-long history may very well figure as that cohesive agent, however tenuous. A strong sense of commonality is that necessary ingredient for the population to cohere and thus to progress for the study of all things Italian-American to become part and parcel of the dominant culture, as it is for other United States hyphenated groups. One added challenge, of course, is that there is greater distance between us Italian Americans and our migratory history. And therefore, we need to make that extra effort to bridge that knowledge gap and in the end also correct some of the narratives we often hear, one being perhaps, for example, the question of quote-unquote legal versus quote-unquote illegal historical Italian immigration. All this is dependent on an Italian American commitment, un impegno, as we say in Italian, to the appreciation of our culture. This entails an active participation in cultural activities of all sorts. It requires that Italian-American groups make a concerted effort to go beyond those one or two activities they have identified as their own and make attempts to expand their agenda to include a new, more encompassing form of cultural integration. All of this is dependent on a combination of cultural awareness and appreciation, namely, a new sense of the Italian-American self that ultimately leads to an appropriation of and strong identification with one's cultural legacy. A concerted conversation, a cuvetere, which is actually a coming together, which is the origin, the etymology of conversation, a concerted conversation then on cultural philanthropy among and by Italian Americans is, I would submit, something necessary to bring us to the table. The concept that's yet to be discussed beyond those few occasions among a small group of individuals. We need to turn to one names on libraries, colleges of arts and humanities, and privately endowed professorships. Two, the lack of a freestanding national museum, and three, graduate programs in Italian Americana, for us to realize how far behind we are in cultural appreciation. Education is the main way we can change people's minds. Italian Americans then must step up to the plate and support grand projects such as a worthy Italian American museum at the national level, endowed professorships and centers, as well as other entities and other institutions dedicated to imparting knowledge of our history and culture. This ultimately brings us to the dire need for private cultural philanthropy. There is a lack of Italian American names on those colleges and university libraries. There's a lack of names on colleges of arts and humanities, and there are very few endowed professors, just to name a few. Less than a dozen names come to mind when discussing private cultural philanthropy vis-a-vis Italian and Italian-American studies. From what I've been able to discern, Unico National has established to date 6 chairs in Italian-American studies, beginning in 1987 with the Emiliana Pasco Noether Chair in Modern Italian History at the University of Connecticut. In turn, Baroness Mariuccia Zirilli Marimò's donation has established in perpetuity the Casa Italiana Zirilli Marimò at New York University. The Joseph and Elda Kocher Institute for Italian Experience in America is at Montclair State University. The Charles and Joan Alberto Italian Studies Institute is at Seton Hall with the Joseph M. Geraldine LaMolta Chair in Italian Studies, also at Seton Hall. And again at Seton Hall is the Valente Family Italian Studies Library, which is a collection of books, Italian books, second to none. And I should add a note here saying maybe second to none, because the Calandra Institute has a 21,500 volume library for which anybody wants to do history on modern and contemporary Italian history, they can come to the Calandra Institute. And on the West Coast, we have the Giorgio Grazia Dio Center for Italian Studies and the George Grazia Dio Chair of Italian American Studies at California State University in Long Beach. Then there is the Emilia Gallucci Cirio Chair at Fitchburg State College. And on a different scale, there's the Esposito Visiting Faculty Fellowship at UMass Dartmouth. Finally, the University of Central Florida has the Dr. Neil Eliano Chair in Italian Studies. The majority, but not all, of these programs include both Italian and Italian-American studies as related fields of intellectual inquiry. To be sure, this is just the beginning of that Italian-American studies has progressed notably over the past 30 years at the college level. There are now a few programs or parts thereof nationwide at the undergraduate level. At the graduate level, instead, the situation is dire, to be sure. One example of possible light at the end of the tunnel is our own Italian Diaspora Studies Summer Seminar. A 3-week program held in collaboration with Roma Tre University, the IDSSS is a professional development seminar for doctoral students and college faculty. At the end of the seminar, fellows come away with a foundational knowledge of the history and culture of the Italian diaspora, which qualifies them to teach an introductory course on, for example, Italian American history and culture. Subject matter covered includes literature, cinema, history, notions of identity, and so on. And the IDSSS benefits from the largesse of a small group of organizations, two individuals, requests made on an annual basis, except for the five-year commitment by the De Luis family. Some questions that then come to mind are, why is it that there are more affluent Italian-American, or why is it that the more affluent Italian-American associations and organizations, especially those that are stridently vocal about what they consider to be Italian heritage and culture in this country, why is it that they do not find fundable educational projects, such as the IDSSS? What is it that steers Italian Americans and their organizations and foundations away from the support of any structural form of Italian and Italian American studies? And here I'm not talking about the numerous scholarships that are given by, and which are extremely important, by the various organizations. I'm going one step beyond. Those are the students. I'm talking about those of us who are there who can impart that knowledge. So that's what I'm talking about. So this is not by any means a critique of the scholarship programs. Those we have, we need, and ben vengono altri. And so in the second case, I have in my the second case of structural support, or the support of a structural form of Italian-American studies, I have in mind the Barinesa Zirilli Marimo's cumulative $8 million contribution to NYU, which resulted in its Casa Italiana, which is the premier center for Italian studies anywhere today, and B, an independent department of Italian. One of the things she said was, I give you this house, but you need to take Italian away from French and so that there is an independent department of Italian. Basically, money talks. And then, of course, there's the Tito Assegno Club that made an invaluable contribution for the Tito Assegno Visiting Professorship in Italian-American Studies at NYU. Curious in all of this is that, while on the one hand finding it difficult to obtain donations for cultural projects from Italian-Americans, on the other hand, unfortunately, discordant intellectual resistance comes also from programs in Italian, many of which still adhere to a canonical notion of what constitutes Italian-American studies, or Italian studies, or what is known in Italy as Italianistica. It is then, for us, unfortunately, a double-edged sword. Indeed, for this to filter down to the public school system, where it is most needed in order to create future thinkers in this regard, access to Italian-American studies for more graduate students needs greater facilitation. This simply will not happen through public funding alone. There needs to be a significant articulation between the academic world and those individuals and foundations of Italian America who can readily underwrite any and all of the above-mentioned entities, centers, and/or institutes. This includes graduate fellowships, so that those in sociology, history, literature, cinema, and the like can dedicate themselves full-time to earning their degrees and not be distracted by having to work part-time. Because many of us have had to follow the second path, it does not mean that our children and grandchildren should do the same. And as we say in Italian, anzi, or as we say in English, au contraire. And here I'm referring to that proverbial statement we've all heard, I had to walk miles to school in the dead of winter. One more example. The Francesco and Mary Giambelli Foundation, to be sure, belongs to this small group of cultural philanthropists mentioned above. It is the first Italian-American foundation to contribute to the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Memorial. Indeed, because of its largesse, we at the John D. Calandra Italian-American Institute were able to invite top scholars and intellectuals who've been negotiating the complex terrain of Italian America, and so that they may each, in their own right, launch various topics Italian Americans need to discuss first and foremost within the group, to then be able to proceed to discuss such topics with other groups, as well as with the hegemonic culture at large. And I'm happy to say that a book of these essays is forthcoming. With an added grant, the foundation also allowed the Calandra Institute to expand its TV coverage. It has proven to be the most significant contribution from any Italian American foundation to the Calandra Institute. All of the above, to be sure, constitutes a great knowledge that lies ahead, indeed a feasible accomplishment. The various above-mentioned centers, professorships, and institutes are proof positive that we can do it. We thus need to engage in a greater conversation with each other, one grounded in dialogue and debate, not in denigration and dismissal. Mutual respect is the operative binomial. Anything short of this is tantamount to failure. Thank you.
Our next speaker is not here because her husband died, Donna Chirico, Sydney. I'd like to dedicate my talk to Sydney. Sydney was a secular Jew, but he was more Italian American than most Italian Americans that I've met outside of the organizations. So I'm going to dedicate my talk to Sydney. But before we do that, I want to tell you, we came up with this idea because we want to bring these ideas to the public and let them speak back to us so that we can continue to build. My idea is to have this type of forum throughout the United States. I'm in dialogue with a number of associations throughout the United States right now, but we wanted to test this. We're taping it. We want them to see, because I think unless we begin to talk about it, I thought I would put up a sign that said Italians only. And I thought that would get, there's nobody from the media here at all, right? The italics is here. And we let everybody know in the media we were doing this, and they, you know, didn't seem to care. And, you know, but if any of us ever committed a crime or got indicted or something like that, or even had a nickname, that would be out there. So that's what we want to do. So after I talk, Donna's talk is out there, by the way. It's a very, very good talk on identity. So after Anthony's talk, she was going to give this beautiful talk on identity. We didn't want anybody else to read it for her. She said, please just hand it out to everybody. So please read it. It's a very, very good discussion and raising some issues, I think, that we need to confront, which would answer Bob's question about, you know, who's Italian, who's not Italian anymore. Finally, what I'd like to say is that this is a response to Anthony's talk, which I had the privilege to read a couple of times before he presented it. And it really represents what I have dedicated my whole life to. So bear with me for about 6-7 minutes. When Niccolo Machiavelli penned his masterpiece, The Prince, Italy was a land divided and besieged by many foreign forces. In his last chapter, An Exhortation to Free Italy from the Hands of the Barbarians, he calls for new weapons and formations to be used in warding off intruders and to prepare for new leadership of Italy. In many ways, the current state of Italian America is in similar straits. We need new tools and new alliances to bring a sense of unification to our culture so that we can ward off the siege of total assimilation. For many years, Italian-American culture has been preserved in the homes, and over the years, more likely than not, in the basement, or what we call basement, where grandpa made wine, where grandma had a second kitchen, and now where we store our material legacies and memories. Outside celebrations, such as religious feste, became the most important public presentations of Italian-American culture. But these annual events were never frequent enough to protect us from the regular mass media bombardment of negative stereotypes. Where Italian Americans have been slow to organize as a cultural group is in the mainstream public institutions. The programs that might have taught Italian Americans the value of their own culture and subsequently fortified future generations, the public programs that would have challenged media-made impressions, were never created. We have kept our heads in our basements, where Italian-American culture is safe inside our family celebrations. Now is the time to move beyond the basements of yesterday and out into the streets of today. The romance and tragedy of early 20th century immigration can no longer serve as models for identity. The key to creating a meaningful sense of Italian-American culture means something to today's youth is to first ensure that they have access to histories of their families, of their communities. Then we must provide them with historical and contemporary models in the areas of arts, business, and education. Models they can study, emulate, and transcend. We have created scholarships for higher education, but we've done little to help those applicants understand what it means to be Italian American once they enter those institutions. This knowledge comes best when it is found in the very stories they hear and read from childhood up through graduate school. When no one documents the struggles of the immigrants, or when those experiences are not transmitted because they are untranslatable, a transnational trauma festers and is fostered that moves unnoticed to the next generation. We are living with these unprocessed traumas that become parasites affecting our public and private behaviors. Until we come face to face with them, with what they are and why they affect us, we will never progress as a culture. This occurs in every family in which the experience of one generation was denied entry into the consciousness of the next. More often than not, this occurred when the language of the immigrants was not passed on to their children. Remember, the immigrants' experiences were processed in Italian or some version of it. And were they not recorded, not passed on from one generation to the next, it's no surprise that nobody can identify as an Italian. And it was likely due to the impossibility of communicating such complex thoughts and feelings in a new language. By the time I learned to read, speak, and write Italian, my grandparents were dead, and my parents stopped speaking the language. What was lost, I could only imagine, so I went in search of those stories. What I found was that while they couldn't control how they passed down a heritage through conscious stories, they certainly did pass down some unconscious elements that we must understand as a culture. Most of our stories have been exploited by others to make money. When we wish to tell our stories, no one wants to hear the ones that don't make money. A publisher told me that while my novel was a good story, I should change the characters to Jews because Jews read and Jews buy books. I was appalled. And that's when I made the switch from wanting to be a writer to becoming a professor, because I thought as a professor, I would have the opportunity to change that. Our stories are testimonies of witness to hard lives that honest and hard work have shaped. If we don't preserve them through the institutions we inherit and create so that they can be learned, we will not have a culture to either protect or promote. These become missed opportunities for understanding and making connections that are vital, not to just knowing ourselves, but also to those around us. Education that doesn't include possibilities for awareness of one's ancestral culture, education that even dares to deny it, make fun of it, creates a disconnect and fosters the search for self elsewhere, preventing an empathy even with those of other cultures. The predominant image of Italian Americans in today's media comes through representation of the working class. The predominant voice of protest of those images comes from Italian Americans in the middle class. What we have here is a classic class struggle. Those educated out of the working class no longer connect to those who have remained working class. Often the result of this class mobility through education is the creation of Americans with Italian names who do not see anything wrong with writing, producing, directing, and acting in films that, while protected by the First Amendment, offend other Italian Americans. For help in understanding this struggle, we need to review similar experiences that occurred in the African American community. When white people watched African slaves entertaining themselves on plantations, they imitated them through minstrel shows that quickly became popular throughout the country. When freed slaves wanted to make their way into mainstream US entertainment, they were limited to playing in those same minstrel shows. They outdid the white actors, and in the process brought a little more humanity to their portrayals. As soon as a black middle class evolved, blacks took offense at these portrayals and protested in much the same way the Italian American community has for over 80 years. But they didn't limit their strategies to protest. Led by such intellectuals as the Harvard educated W.E.B. Du Bois, they focused on developing what he referred to as the talented 10th. Through the establishment of black colleges, black studies programs, black businesses, black cultural products and consumers, African Americans educated themselves and by the 1920s created arts to be studied and emulated. By the 1960s, they created a social and political awareness that challenged racist histories and legacies. And by the 70s, were able to produce independent filmmakers who made sure the rest of the world saw their lives in different ways. While Italian Americans have been busy becoming good Americans, America has spent a great deal of time nurturing what we might call our untalented 10th. Why has the bottom of Italian American culture gained the spotlight and infamy? Why? Because we have never organized our culture the way others have, and now we are paying for it by fighting sophisticated image makers with out-of-date weapons. For Italian American culture to survive, we must nationalize the education of Italian Americans first in order to understand why the Coppola, Scorsese's, and Chases achieved success through the minstrel show mill, and why few, if any, Italian Americans with any kind of real power in politics, the media, the arts, religion, ever come to the aid of those who wanted to protest defamation of Italian Americans. And here I have to stop, since we have Judge Russo in the crowd, and applaud the incredible work that his sons have done to create new generations of filmmakers who focus on Italian American culture. Think of all the Italian Americans who have gone through the media mill in the last 100 years, from Frank Capra all the way up to Coppola and David Chase. None of them have given a single penny to Italian-American education. Certainly Scorsese has given some money to Italian film and so on. But this is the point. But things are happening. Things are changing. And it didn't happen because of their education at school. It happened because who their father was. That's my idea. Once you become aware of the impact Italians have had on U.S.-American culture from its earliest explorations to its latest scientific advances, you realize that you could stop just about any point in American history and find an Italian influence. Just as we wouldn't have had the great tradition of Italian arts without patronage, we won't have a strong Italian-American culture without modern-day Medici. If you go home with anything tonight, take my bumper sticker, modern-day Medici, to support education and the efforts of our own talented 10th. Thank you.
What's the difference in effect between having a chair of Italian American Studies and an institute of Italian American Studies?
So there is a difference in function. Traditionally, a chair occupied by someone who is of a certain reputation, etc., usually is going to attract students, and a chair usually is with a graduate program. And so we can debate the value of a chair for just an undergraduate program. Undergraduates don't look for who the teachers are as much as graduates do. That's the main difference. The institute instead is a place where certain research activities can take place. That research can be presented to the public, that research could in public programming, lectures, symposia, etc. But also that research can also be published. And the fact that it's published, it gets an ISBN number, and it becomes part and parcel of this international database of things, and then it goes in the Library of Congress and other databases. But that's the basic difference, is that, and so one can very much question the chairs that exist. I'm not saying we should, but one can.
My name is, my family name is Vincent Romeo, Vincenzo Romeo. And this is what my mind is going at 10,000 miles an hour right now with what I'm hearing. I'm actually an actor named Paul Vincent. And when I signed with the big agency back before De Niro and Pacino, they asked me to change my name. And I did. My middle name was Paul. I dropped the Romeo. Partly there was another actor named Romeo Vincent in the union, and I didn't want to get confused, but partly I went along with it. I mean, I grew up in Cleveland, Ohio. Life with Luigi was the big radio program. It made fun of Italians and of the immigrant. My father listened to it. He was an immigrant, and he laughed. And you mentioned the, you know, the shows in vaudeville that everybody is looking back to now. We did that in those days. We heard the word dago. We heard the word wop. when my sister was studying Italian at our local library, when the war happened, it was gone. Italian was gone. So we grew up, you know, not loving the whole thing of being Italian. We had our cultural lives. We did it at home. We kept the culture going. My father was very good. He insisted on English at home, but we kept everything cultural going. So I'm a little bit confused in a way, because I think today when I see Italian names listed on TV, and I think, boy, you see more Italian names now and that we never saw. And I think it's a great thing that Italians are becoming more a part. They've gotten educated. My sister and I were the first in our family to go to college. They're educated today. You see their names in all kinds of ways. I think this is a good thing. But how we keep the culture, that's another thing. And that's where my mind is thinking. I just want to say one more thing. I have two books outside, a little ad for my two books outside. I wrote a book called My Villa in Calabria, which is about an Italian immigrant, my father, and what he left in Italy, and how it was painful for him. He was able, and there are secrets that we never knew, that he had left a wife in Italy who did not want to come.
Get to the other one, because we don't have a lot of time.
I'm over.
Okay.
No, I'm just, that's it. Yeah. But what I'm saying is I want to look at the immigrants, and my book does, and it shows the pain that a lot of it was, you know, that went on. My father left his family. His two brothers could not get into America. They went to Buenos Aires. And, but I'm my two books behind the store, we had a grocery store, are about the culture of what we had. And that's, I just want to say that I'm here with you.
Good.
And we have to keep that culture.
Let me say something, and then we have one more question in the back. Let me say something about Life with Luigi, because
yes,
because it was also, in addition to Life with Luigi, there was Bonino, another widower with children. And what people don't realize is that, and this is part of sort of our cultural appreciation and going back to study, that there would be, I'd submit to you that there would be no My Three Sons if there weren't Life with Luigi and Bonino. In other words, we don't realize how important those programs were. And so what that does is it gives us talking points. So the next time somebody laughs about Life with Luigi, you can say, hey, chooch, hold up. You know, there'd be no My Three Sons without. So it's important for us to recontextualize.
Yes.
Mike?
Yes, thank you. Would you please speak to two points? One, explain about the curriculum in our schools around the country in terms of how it's changed from one point to the other with regard to Italian history and Columbus and so forth. And two, tell us, in your view, how we can change that at a grassroots point. Yeah. Thank you.
There are two things. One is the studying of Italian American history. That is, we don't as a country really study our own immigration history. Therefore, we remain. I always lecture the Italians when I'm in Italy about how they don't study their immigration history. Therefore, they don't know who we are, right? Italian American. But we don't study it either, and so we have to start doing that. But there's a wonderful curriculum that has sort of remained in about a 40-mile radius of New Jersey that Gilda Baldissaro did years ago. And for some reason, that curriculum has never been expanded. It starts with 10 and 15 minute units. And that curriculum really needs to be sort of resuscitated and maybe spread more on a national level. That's the first thing. It takes funding to do that. And the other thing is the study of Italian. Because if we don't insist on the study of Italian, we lose that access point into Italian culture, and then therefore into also understanding better our own history. And that's where it takes what I call I have called intellectual activism. That is, we need to make sure that we're there calling the principal, calling the principal of the school, calling the supervisor of the district, and so on and so forth. But we also have to do it in a respectable manner. We can do it in a strident but respectable manner. And we can't engage in any type of name calling and things of that sort, of which we've been victim, the Calandra Institute, over the years, when we presented a lecture on Guido culture. And I'm happy to say that half the people who came, who were suspicious of what we were doing, came away convinced and said they understood that there's this certain angle of Italian America that they didn't know existed. That doesn't mean it's good or bad. We just need to know it exists.
We also need to know how we work within cultural institutions. You go to your public library, you ask for Vince's book. You go to your PTA meetings. You go to your parent-teacher conferences. You ask them, what are you teaching? I came home from school and my grandfather said, what'd you learn today? I said, oh, I learned Capone. Capone was a, he said, did they tell you Capone built soup kitchens? Did they tell you Capone put money in an orphanage? I said, no. He goes, go back to school and tell them. All right. So we don't learn everything. You know, you think the Irish, why did the Irish come here? Potato famine. Why were there potato famine? Because potatoes don't belong in Ireland. The English put them there so the Irish could raise them for them. And when they went bad, because potatoes are where? Idaho. When's the last time you heard of a bad rainstorm in Idaho? You know? This is the point. There are causes. I asked my grandmother, why did you come to the United States? I had been to, and she said, miseria. Why was there miseria? They never explained. I had to go into my own studies to figure, and when I learned what happened, I was incredibly upset. And when I went to my professors and I said, how come we don't have an Italian American literature class? Oh, you guys don't count, you guys are white, you know. I'd spent the rest of my life, I was working on Walt Whitman. There's nobody more American than Walt Whitman in terms of poetry. I switched, and when I switched, I got thrown out of the University of Chicago. But I stuck with what I did and fostered whatever I could in my life to change that. So we all can do many, many things. If you don't know what to do, then you go contact somebody in an institute who have experience working with these. I once gave a talk to a group of working class people out on Long Island, and they said, you know, I got a friend who's a lawyer, I got a friend, you know, what do I need to give money to a chair for an institute, or for chair for, you know, he says, you know, I don't understand with this, you know, it's a public institution, why don't they do that? You know, I'm not gonna give money to Stony Brook University, they get my tax dollars. All right, until we learn how to create our own agendas within these institutions. And it doesn't take a lot. Ask any activist parent teacher association mother who changed the culture of her school. It could be done by one person getting other people involved. This is exactly why I want to have a town hall meeting. Like, I'll spend the rest of my life going around the rest of the United States saying this, you know, because I think when we get into the next panel, we're going to find that there's a lot of other issues that we need to look at. I think, anybody have, Melina, no. Have one?
I am a professor at Amherst College in Poughkeepsie, and I teach four sections of Italian every semester because that is the situation now. No tenure tracks are being hired in Italian, so I'm still a lecturer with a doctorate. But I don't want you to feel bad for me because I do love what I do. And I really do try to improve the situation. But I wanted to respond to the question about what you can do, because I'm also the co-chair of the American Association for Teachers of Italian Advocacy Committee. And I've spent the entire day today working on saving a program in East Syracuse, Manoa. And I just got a text on my phone from one of the students who desperately wants Italian to continue. And as soon as I finish here, I'm going to go call her. What you guys have to do, which you don't know probably, is that every single year, Italian programs in high schools and middle schools across the United States decreased by 20%. At that rate, we figured out that by 2030, there would be no more Italian programs at that level, which is great. Well, you know, I'm not going to say how old I'll be then, but you know, for a lot of people, they tend to not care because they're not going to be here. It doesn't affect them. But if you want your kids and your grandkids and their kids to keep learning Italian, you got to get involved. And the only way to do that at that level is to be involved in the school system. You are a taxpayer, so you have a right to say something at the Board of Election meetings. You have a right to call the principals, the superintendents. You have a right to speak up. Your kids and grandkids do too. And so a lot of people don't know that they can, but we have saved, last year we saved 3 programs. It's not a huge amount because a lot of our got canceled, but that's how we did it. Grassroots, calling, petitions, and just being angry.
Good evening. I'm going to preface my remarks by making a rather bold assertion. I, Angelo Vivolo, and Mike Santo will present the unified position of the Italian-American community as it relates to the current controversy surrounding Christopher Columbus. What I mean by that statement is quite simple and straightforward. Every major Italian-American fraternal organization in the United States, including the National Italian-American Foundation, the Order of Sons and Daughters of Italy in America, the Columbus Heritage Foundation, Unico National, the Italian Sons and Daughters of America, and all of the 40 member organizations of the Conference of Presidents of Major Italian-American Organizations, all adamantly support the retention of Columbus Day, and all rigorously oppose the vilification of Christopher Columbus through the efforts of those who attempt to rewrite American history to conform to their own misguided social and political agendas. Any person who alleges to be Italian American and espouses a position contrary to that which I have stated speaks only for themselves and not on behalf of the Italian American community. And further, it is the consensus in our community that those Italian Americans who do not support our collective position on the Columbus issue either exhibit a gross lack of understanding of the significance this issue's had historically in the Italian American community, or should they appreciate that significance, then they lack any respect for our shared heritage. I'll now present a brief synopsis of the history of the Columbus controversy. For the past 500 years, excuse me, for the first 500 years after his arrival, Columbus was a hero throughout the Americas. The Chicago World's Fair of 1892 was named the Columbian Exposition to honor him, and over 27 million Americans attended the fair. The first U.S. postage commemorative stamp was issued to celebrate Columbus. And the Pledge of Allegiance was first recited by school children to coincide with Columbus celebrations. Fast forward to the 500th anniversary in 1992, and we find some historical revisionists, some Native Americans, and some student activists attempting to vilify Columbus, often with exaggerated and sometimes wholly fabricated facts. Initially, their argument was presented under the guise that Columbus did not measure up to the standards and values that exist in our society today. And as has been said so poignantly by Dr. Aileen Seary and by Angelo Vivolo in a recent op-ed article in the New York Post, I quote, "In our eagerness to search out scapegoats for the injustices of history, Christopher Columbus became the fall guy for the sins of slavery, the exploitation of the indigenous people, the spread of disease, and every other ill that confronted the New World," unquote. As the Columbus discussion has evolved over the past several years, it's become increasingly evident that the real motive of those who attack Columbus is their desire to vilify and condemn the European colonization of America, the tenets of Western civilization, as well as the Catholic Church. Those critics attempt to paint a portrait of America as being a land of utopia for Native Americans prior to Columbus's arrival, and that all the ills that have beset the Native American community from Columbus's arrival to this day are the result of the European colonization that Columbus initiated. And they choose to attempt to rewrite our history to conform to that view by using emotionally charged words such as slavery and genocide when they describe Columbus. In fact, the truth is quite different. The civilization that Columbus encountered upon his arrival involved bloody wars among the tribes. The long-standing practice of slavery among the tribes, and in some cases, the practice of human sacrifice and cannibalism, which were unknown in Europe at that time. As relates to the allegations of Columbus initiating slavery in the Americas, Christopher Columbus never owned a slave, and the first slave ship to travel from Africa to the Americas did not arrive on our shores until 1619, over 100 years after Columbus died. And so we should question whether these same critics, under the dictates of multiculturalism, will condemn George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, who lived 250 years after Columbus and who owned slaves. They have not yet, because of the perceived backlash they would be subjected to throughout our country. However, if they're successful in their efforts to demonize Columbus, they will most certainly proceed to attack Washington and Jefferson because it is the next logical step for them in their effort to condemn European colonization of America. Let's next address the issue of genocide. The term genocide is also routinely used by those who argue that Columbus brought diseases to the New World from Europe, which caused the death of many Native Americans. That assertion is another blatant lie. Genocide is the willful, deliberate, and systematic killing of a particular group of people. No such effort was ever undertaken by Christopher Columbus. Diseases have always been a part of the natural course of human evolution, and until recently have been a blight that humanity has had little or no control over. To blame Columbus for the spread of disease is as absurd an argument as blaming Native Americans for all the ills that tobacco, cocaine, and syphilis have caused the world, as it was the Native Americans who passed those drugs and diseases along to the Europeans. Now let's address the reasons why Italian Americans have such a special bond with Cristoforo Colombo. The reasons that never appear in our history books or are taught to our children in school, but which rightfully deserve to be part of this discussion. Over 4 million Italian immigrants, 85% of whom were from the impoverished regions of southern Italy, arrived in our country between 1880 and 1920. They represented the largest number of immigrants to enter America from any country during that period of time. Due to their inability to speak the language, their lack of education, their dark complexions, their Catholic religion, and their sheer numbers, they were not welcomed in their new land. They were socially ostracized and forced to live in squalid conditions in what were termed Little Italies. They were only allowed to work the lowest and most lowest paying and most dangerous jobs. And they were subjected to hostility, violence, and prejudice. As we're all aware, in 1891, the largest documented mass lynching in American history took place in New Orleans when 11 Italian immigrants were shot and hung by a mob of 5,000 people for their alleged murder of the city's police chief. All 11 had been tried in a court of law, and a jury had found none of them to be guilty. This barbaric act was not only condoned, but it was actually applauded by prominent politicians and several newspapers, including the New York Times. The following year, President Benjamin Harrison, who strongly condemned the lynchings, called for a nationwide celebration of Columbus Day to promote unity and patriotism in America. His decision to honor Columbus served to create a groundswell of pride among Italian immigrants who began to hold Columbus Day parades and celebrations in an attempt to establish a sense of dignity and self-worth for themselves in the very hostile environment that they were subjected to throughout our country. Over time, Columbus Day evolved into a celebration of Italian-American heritage, a day to recognize the sacrifices, the accomplishments, and the contributions our community has made to this great country. Anti-Italian sentiment remained deep-seated in our country for decades thereafter and would manifest itself publicly with the egregious Sacco-Vanzetti trial and their subsequent executions in 1927, as well as the enemy alien directives of World War II, which subjected up to 600,000 Italians living in the United States to various losses of civil liberties, including curfews, confiscation of property, relocation from their homes, loss of employment, and even in some cases, internment, while over a million of their sons fought and died in Europe and the South Pacific to defend this country. As a result of the critical role Columbus's historic accomplishments played in the gradual assimilation of Italian Americans into mainstream America, our community is rightfully very sensitive to what we believe are unwarranted attacks designed to diminish his stature in world history. Christopher Columbus, again, as so eloquently stated by Dr. Siri, is a 15th century man being tried by a self-righteous 21st century jury in a 21st century courtroom. Under such conditions, fair and impartial justice can never be dispensed. By today's standards, Columbus possessed human flaws, as did every other historical figure. But no one can dispute the fact that his epic voyage forever changed the course of world history, leading to the creation of our great country and its immeasurable contributions to the development of democracy, education, science, medicine, and technology, which have benefited all of mankind. The Italian-American community will never forget that Columbus Day recognizes the monumental historic event that began the process of over 500 years of worldwide immigration to America by people seeking a better life for their families. And that's why our community will forever defend his rightful place as one of the greatest figures in world history. Now, there's an ancillary but very important issue underlying this entire discussion, and that is the lack of respect shown to the Italian-American community by certain segments of the media in its unwillingness to afford our community the ability to express our point of view, and its unwillingness to extend our community the status of an aggrieved minority group within our society, which it routinely extends to every other group. The most poignant example being the New York Times refusal to issue an apology for their editorial written 2 days after the New Orleans lynchings, which applauded the brutal actions taken by that mob. That issue will be addressed in more detail by one of our subsequent speakers. However, the exposure and rectification of this issue, us being disrespected by the media, should begin to gradually resolve itself as a result of the pressure our community applies to the media in speaking with a louder and more unified voice regarding our position on Columbus, as well as other important issues that affect our community. Thank you. We have two exceptional speakers who will contribute to this discussion. Angelo, we are here tonight as the guests of our next speaker. He is the president of the
Chairman of the Board, former president
of the Columbus Heritage Foundation, Angelo Vivolo, and I believe the chairman of the New York City Columbus Day Parade.
Yes.
And then we will hear from Mike Santo, a very accomplished attorney who was instrumental in orchestrating the apology that was rendered by the mayor of the city of New Orleans to our community as a result of the 1891 lynchings that occurred in that community. Mike will also address potential legal issues that our community is considering with respect to several of these issues. So let's welcome Angelo.
Tough act to follow. Actually, he said so many things that I think we all know and I would like to also address, but first I'll get some basic information out and correct it. I'm the former president of the Columbus Foundation, the president, chairman of the board, and I'm the president of the Columbus Heritage Coalition. I think we all wear multiple hats these days to preserve our culture and to preserve our heritage. I have a little bit more of a positive outlook on where we are, where we stand, and what we've done. For example, here at the Columbus Citizens Foundation, we have almost 700 youngsters in the scholarship program. They all have to have some blood, Italian blood in them. So I think when they go on to college, you know, they go on to high schools, they'll feel that they were helped by our community, by an Italian-American community supporting them. So I think it's a very positive thing. The Columbus Citizens Foundation, when the initial program came out for the AP program that was dying, that was done away with, the Columbus Foundation donated $500,000 to bring that program back. And I'm happy to say that it's a very strong program because language, as was said earlier, is so important for our culture. There's no question about it. And there's a lot more that can be done. And I agree with everyone who spoke so far that, you know, we need to celebrate our culture. We need to have others know who we are and what we stand for. Now I'll give you my job tonight was to give you a little bit of a history as to how we started uniting in a better sense our community. As you all know, for many, many years, Italian-American, all the various organizations, well-intended as they may have been, kind of worked in their own way, and we didn't work together. And I'm here tonight to tell you that I believe that's changing. It happened with a kind of silver lining in the summer of 2017, August of that year. As you all know, the challenge was to take down the statue of Christopher Columbus in Columbus Circle. At that time, I was the president of the Columbus Foundation, and I had wrote a letter, and I asked my board if we could have that letter on a full page in the New York Times and the New York Daily News and the Post. And as you know, to publicize, as someone said earlier, you know, cost money. And it cost this foundation $120,000 to do that. But what it did, it was money well spent, because what it did, it really woke up our community. And for too long, we've been too easy and not speak up promote ourselves. We allowed others to marginalize us and to not to speak in proper terms about all the great things that Italian Americans and Italians have done throughout the world. So after that, my statements went out. I was bombarded with so many various groups and people that wanted to promote and unite. And so out of that, we created the Columbus Heritage Coalition, which is made up of about 40 various organizations. Many are here tonight, and we made a united effort to get the Columbus statue protected. We made an application to the city of New York first, and the city doesn't really work very fast, except when we requested this monument to become part of our history. In 6 days, I got the refusal from the city that wasn't going to happen. So then my next approach was to Governor Cuomo, and we made an application to the state for having the state recognize the statue as a historical monument. And very fortunate, it took a while, but we had the state accept it and create to identify the monument as a national monument. And then it went into the National Registry as a national monument. So the bottom line is that Christopher Columbus will always stay at Columbus Circle. It's never going to be touched. It was the beginning of the galvanizing of the support of Italian American community. And I really believe that is the way it is now. I think those days when people worked independently are behind us. I have many friends in this room, Aileen Siri and Joe Shami and John Viola, and I go on and on and on. Forgive me if I don't mention everybody, but all of my friends in this room right now, and others that aren't here, we're all working together now. We're all trying to do our best to come together. Last year, I had a meeting with my friend Basil Russo and Joe Shami, and I can't remember, there was someone else with us. But we had talked about how can we educate, how can we get the public to know the truth because of the false narrative that goes out there. And we've never confronted the false narrative. We just let it be. And you know, as it goes on and on and on, people believe lies. So we came up with this idea that we should have a national organization. We should have a National Columbus Education Foundation. And fortunately, we, after some time, we were able to create this organization. It's a 501c3. It's in Washington at the NEOF dinner. We're going to have that meeting with Aileen and the Conference of Presidents, and we're going to talk a little about it then. But we're going to really put this into the works. It is important for us to work not only through political and legislation, those are all important things to prevent the taking away of Columbus and replacing it. By the way, we're all in favor of Indigenous Peoples Day. We just don't want it to be on Columbus Day, that's all. And I think that's something that we would help them build their statue if they wanted, or create there is a day, by the way, August 9th is the International Day for Indigenous people, and the month of November is dedicated to Indigenous people. And you know, for all the reasons that my friend Basil said earlier, it just is incredible that they still want to talk negatively and take away Columbus Day. It's just mind-boggling, to tell you the truth. This is going to be a very important organization, and we have unity of the major Italian organizations in the country that are going to be behind it, because we believe strongly in education and we believe strongly in getting the curriculum changed and getting it out. And you need, as I think Anthony said, you need money to do it. And we have commitment by some major organizations and outside foundations to do this. And so we're hoping that we will be successful, and that next year we have this conference here again, we can report to you on the positive works of the National Columbus Education Foundation. It's a mouthful, but we're certainly working hard to make that happen. I want to also report to you tonight that I'm very pleased, and I'm sure you've seen it in the paper if you haven't already, but I was with Governor Cuomo last week on Friday for about an hour, myself and Bishop DiMarzio, and the governor committed $750,000, it's official today, committed $750,000 to create the Cabrini statue. So we're very happy that that's gonna happen. And some of our friends in this room were on that, Joe Shami and John Viola and myself were on that commission, in addition to about 16 or 17 other people. But I think that's a step forward. As I said on Columbus Day, they asked me to make a statement. Divert from Columbus to Mother Cabrini for a second. She was not only for Italian Americans, for Catholics, but she was for all immigrants. And the fact that she was not recognized was really, really an offense to all of us. But I want to thank Basil for his incredible, incredible report tonight. He is an incredible guy, and what he did in Cleveland to save Columbus Day is just amazing. So congratulations, Basil, and I'll give the floor to another friend.
Hi, good evening. First of all, I want to thank all of you for coming. You're spending time here because I'm sure you think this is important. I know it's important. My name is Mike Santo. I know these two gentlemen, and I'm very proud to be with these two gentlemen speaking on this topic. First, I want to congratulate Angelo on that issue with Mother Cabrini. I think as a bad experience that we had with the city, we wind up with a very, very positive outcome with the state. I don't think the city would ever have committed $750,000 for a statue for Mother Cabrini. So that turns out to be a positive note. I'm a positive person. Although I work hard and I'm a mudge, I'm pretty good at that. My mother always said I was a pain in the ass, and frankly, I've chosen the right profession. I'm a lawyer. You can laugh at that. It's all right. But it's worked out well for me. I'm going to make a couple of remarks about how to help render this thing that we're dealing with. I'm going to give you two positive examples. One is a microcosm. The other is a national, even an international issue. And then I'm going to talk to you about some legal matters that we're contemplating. First, the points. Columbus Day is more than about the man and the individual. And if we were to argue about him versus the indigenous peoples, we're going to lose. There's no question about that, especially with the atmosphere today. The educational system and the curriculum has been running against us for two decades, if not more. So it's very tough to fight that issue. We, in my view, have to look at Columbus Day as something that is ours. We're celebrating our history, our culture, our people, all of the positive things. So how can you take that away from us? Well, that's what we have to get at. Point two, this involves politics. If you think otherwise, you're a bit naive. This involves politics. And there's something called the countervailing theory of pressure politics. What that is that if one side yells and screams and puts in money and funds to make a PAC or an organization go forward, and they're out there waving flags, guess what's going to happen? They're going to get what they want. Now, we, as a people, as an American, as an Italian-American culture in this country, we have benefited so much. We've come so far that our own success has been our problem because we've remained complacent. Let's admit it, we have. We've sat down, we've let that curriculum go forward, we've let people talk about us, let people create movies that are mob-related all the time. We put up with things because of our own success. We say, it's okay. We have an Italian governor. We have an Italian on the Supreme Court bench. We have this, and we do. But we forgot something. We forgot that we are a silent majority. It's not just us. You can put in any ethnic group and say, you have to stick up for your background. Why wouldn't you? I think we should stick up for anyone else's background. So when it comes to the politics, I'm going to tell you how a microcosm issue that came out to be positive worked in that favor. The third point that Angelo said, I believe, is we're not going to denigrate indigenous peoples. We'll lose every time. We're for them. We want them to have a day. Again, just not Columbus Day. Why Columbus Day is swapped out for Indigenous Peoples Day is not a mystery to me. It's spiteful. It's saying, I don't want that day, and I'm going to put this day in its place. Unfortunately, there is no one organization representing all of the splinter groups of American Indians or Indigenous peoples in this country. They're broken up into tribes. If you think Italy had problems over the years unifying, try and unify the American Indians or the Indigenous peoples. There is no one organization to go to. And you're going to get different answers from different tribes in terms of how to address this issue. So that's why it's not that simple. It's very complicated. I'm going to give you a microcosm issue on a positive note. Does anyone here live on Long Island? You familiar with Southampton?
Yeah.
All right. You may not have a house there, but you're familiar with it, right? So in Southampton, it's a town, and there's a tribal unit that has its place there. It's called the Shinnecock Indians. What happened over the course of years at the local school board is that the Shinnecock Indians were very successful in placing their own folks on the school board to the point where they had a majority. And guess what happened? Columbus Day's gone. Indigenous peoples are there. So what did we do? Well, with the help of the Order of Sons of Italy in America and the Commission for Social Justice, both groups at the time of which I was a council, we put together an ad, a full-page ad, and through a grassroots movement, we got people involved. Phone calls were made, especially through about three or five people who are local to Southampton. We helped them. We helped finance a couple of things. Phone calls were made, and guess what happened at the next vote? We gained a seat. The next year, we gained a seat. Guess what happened? Countervailing theory, oppression politics. Columbus Day is back. So I say the microcosm because it will work on a state, a county, national level. There's no question about it. It all goes back to the complacency that we keep having. We have to move. We have to get off our collective duffs and say something. Join the local school board, as the doctor said, right? Be active in a polite manner. So I'm here to vote. I'm a voter. I want answers. So now the other one. I was very proud and scared at first to have been given a chore 13 months ago. I was tasked with finding out how we can get an apology from the current mayor of New Orleans 128 years after something happened in 1891. I didn't know what the hell was going to happen. I have no idea. All I know is that I couldn't use a committee from New York to handle it. It had to be done internally. So a couple of flights down in New Orleans, I befriended three wonderful people. I'm not going to mention their names, but these three people became the committee, the go-to people, and we organized a pressure, we made phone calls, we educated the people on the city board and a particular mayor, and we happened to have the right mayor at the right time. A liberal black woman from a very poor section of California who went to school on an undergraduate basis in New Orleans, Harvard educated, came back to New Orleans, and she rose up through the ranks and became the mayor. And son of a gun, she appointed some fella on her staff who was a local Italian kid from Brooklyn by the name of Pasquale Pasquitonio. Yeah, that's right, you can't make it up. And he's living in New Orleans. And so he was my point man, basically saying, will you stop at the emails, stop at the phone calls? You know, help him. Mike, get rid of Mike Stanton. Let's get this thing done. We came to terms with regard to the apology, and we had an absolute wonderful presentation. The mayor not only handed off the proclamation with all of the language that we wanted in it, but it was covered by, ready? Associated Press, New York Times, Washington Post, CNN, BBC, French National Radio, Canadian National Radio, Australia Press. I had interviews with many of them. Other folks had interviews with other people. It kept on going. This became viral as the word really means viral around the country and around the nation and around the world, not only because it was sexy, And I think it was sexy because of the killings. And who ever heard about Italians being lynched? My God, no one knew about it. But we rose up to the ranks and made this something that people weren't aware of. People were scared. What do you mean? 11 men were lynched. It didn't make sense. But when the story was told, and then the apologies was given, there's a secret I want to tell you about. The room was packed at the American Italian Cultural Center in New Orleans. About 8 of those people who attended were relatives of the victims of that lynching. There were about 5 people who were present who were relatives of the people, as I call, on the other side of the equation. Because what made this lynching so bad wasn't just the fact that people were hung and killed. It was that the city government and the mayor and the future governor of Louisiana were complicit in putting together this gang and having this rampage happen. So for 128 years, these folks are living and working together, knowing that this was always on their shoulders. It was a burden. It was a cultural stain on the Italian American community. And this helped it tremendously. And it was not over. Part 2 of the project is to go there and erect a statue. And I'm very much involved in that. So now that leaves us to the third point that I want to make. So what are we doing legally? What's our game plan here? There are about at least 10 states that have swapped out Columbus Day for Indigenous Peoples Day. That's important when I say swapped out, because that's a spiteful act, because Indigenous Peoples Day could be any number of days that's more relative to their history, but they want to, and I say they, let me go back. They meaning the government, they meaning the city, the state, the county, all of these people are governmental officials that make this determination because they're listening to the people rattling the cage, all right? Again, countervailing theory of pressure politics. It's time for us to rattle the cage. So how do we do it? Well, there's a number of different fronts. Basil talked about it. Angela talked about other things. The professor talked about education. Let me talk about legal. So we have a team that was put together by Angelo through the Columbus Heritage Coalition. It's called the Legal Study Group. It sounds like students at law school, by the way. Yeah. But,
you guys are great.
Well, we try. These folks are great. I'm really happy to be with the crowd. So we're trying to make a determination. Out of the 10 states, which 1, 2, or 3 states would be the best state to attack legally in the court system? And we kind of came up with Maine and Florida and perhaps Vermont. And one of the factors for that, we looked at the indigenous people population in the states. We looked at the Italian-American population in those states. We looked at the politics, the policies, the political folks there. And basically, what we're thinking about doing is bringing on a Civil Rights Act lawsuit, because this is our civil rights. If you were to transplant Italian with some other group, and you say, well, they're going to have a civil rights suit for sure, you know that's happening. It's going to happen tomorrow. Well, it may not happen tomorrow for us, but damn well it's going to happen, right? Because we're not going to give up. And if we do, then guess what? We're complacent again. So we're going to look at that. And it's not just us who are going to act. We have some money, right, Angelo?
Yes.
Good. So what we're going to do is we're going to retain some high-powered firms that have clout in the individual states. Because Mike Santo or any number of these good folks on the committee, they can't walk in from these different states and say, hi, I'm from New York, I'm going to come into Florida, and I'm going to change the law. You know, that's not going to be very welcome. No, we're going to hire a very powerful firm in Florida, in Maine, in Vermont, to look at the issues and tell us, are we crazy? Are we going to? What's the likelihood of success? All right, what are the obstacles in our way? And even if we don't win, we're going to bring it to the attention of the press because we're going to keep on going and going and going. That's our plan, folks. I hope it works out. Thank you very much.
My name is Richard Materi. I did get a grant to write, direct, and produce a documentary from the Russo Brothers Film Forum called Where Are We Now? The Italian American Today. And I want to thank you for fighting to keep Christopher Columbus statue there, because my entire documentary starts there with me in a B-roll and ends there. And I purposely picked it because of the controversy. And there's some, I don't know if you've been there, it's a gorgeous statue. And when you read the writing, and I hope I get this right, I say it in the documentary, but I don't remember. He brought a world. Yes. And a lot of such intelligent stuff here is said tonight. What was really interesting, though, and Fred and Anthony are in the documentary, and they're amazing because they brought all the history and intelligence. My idea was to find young immigrants to see what they thought of Italian Americans. And what was really interesting is a lot of them really don't know who we are. And they can't tell the difference between us and Germans, Irish. But what was really, really interesting is that those that did know us knew us through traditions. So what was brought up today is my whole point of the documentary is have we been totally assimilated by the American culture, or are we still Italian American? And I have to tell you, it ends on the fact of immigrants come here all the time, and that's what Christopher Columbus is all about, and that's why I wanted to shoot it there and end it there. And the fact that the question is, and I noticed, like, most of the younger people that I was talking to, like I said, didn't know us because they thought we were the Americans. And when I talk to older Italians, as we're hearing tonight, older, smarter, wiser people, there's so much that isn't known. And I think Anthony said one of the smart, Fred said the last one thing, but Anthony said one of the smartest things, and I think it was, we did not retain our language. And that is why I think we look like we totally assimilated and we are the Americans to the new immigrants.
Hi, I'm Bill Russo, and I've been involved in, you might say, community activism for my entire professional career, and now that I'm retired. I was an executive at the New York City Housing Authority. I worked in low-income housing throughout the city of New York, grassroots level. I heard the word grassroots. Well, grassroots can dry up unless they're fed. And I've seen in minority neighborhoods throughout the city in public housing how people rally to support the local community facilities, the centers, the basketball programs, the dancing, the Black History Month, and all of those wonderful, wonderful activities. And I'm getting to my question, and that is, how do we address the grassroots of our own Italian Americans in the communities? And we have a brave and wonderful teacher who has a positive attitude. And I like a lot of the positivity that's coming out of Angelo and the work he's doing, and the Basil and his sons, the Russo brothers, getting that media attention to offset the negative stereotypes is a wonderful thing. There are community centers throughout the city which do involve Italian Americans and try to get Italian American or Italian culture and language programs. I'll give one example. Mike, my good friend Mike, we've been working with recently on the Cabrini issue. We were honored recently by Italian Charities of America. They have a community facility on Queens Boulevard in Queens. Wonderful programming, they're teaching Italian. They have a very large Chinese population, which is another dynamic we should really pay attention to. The Calandra Institute does that. Nowadays, the definition of what is Italian and being Italian is really sometimes not so clear. You can be born in America, not even of an Italian heritage, and you can feel and act and be Italian. And the question is, how do we address places like Italian Charities of America, which, by the way, was funded originally by Generoso Pope, who founded this building here, and how do we get them funded and fed so their grassroots don't dry up?
Right, I'm actually going to say something that you said earlier, which is that in our communities, in our organizations, we have to do things to promote with the youth. And I'm going to once again talk about the Columbus Foundation. We have young adults, it's about 120 youngsters who are either former recipients of our scholarship or have been youngsters who have been sponsored by others.
to be a member of that organization. In addition to that, what we've done at the Columbus Citizens Foundation, we created a category of membership so that it was affordable for a young adult who is from 21 to 35 to be a member of the foundation at a completely inexpensive rate, and we have been very successful with that. So I think to partially answer Bill's comment about how do we get people involved, youngsters especially, is by the grassroots, by the people, by the various organizations, leaders in this room, to get the young people involved and to motivate them to be part of what we're doing.
We need to be realistic about the issue with young people because we need to be aggressive about it. Because if we're not, when we die, the culture and the heritage dies with us. The problem we are confronted with today is that we are now into the fourth and fifth generation of Italian Americans. These young people have no ties to the immigrant generation. They don't feel the passion that we feel. They didn't grow up with it. They didn't have a nono or a nona that influenced their lives dramatically, that they want to continue to show love and respect for even though they're gone. So what we need to do, I think, is as follows. It appears that everybody is interested in learning about their past. You know, when you see these commercials repeatedly on television of Ancestry.com and other such companies, they're obviously all making a lot of money. And they're doing it because people want to find out about themselves. They want to find out about their roots. They want to find out about where they came from. So what we need to do is we now have these young people that are a quarter Italian, maybe an eighth Italian. So they either don't identify with anything or they identify with a myriad of things. We need to convince them that our heritage is beautiful. Our heritage is strong. We have great traditions. We have many wonderful values to identify with, so that becomes the most appealing part of who they are to them. And they want to identify with being Italian American, even if they're only a quarter Italian American. They want to hold out to the world, that's who I am. And so that's our challenge, is to convince these young people that aspect of who they are is the most important aspect of who they are, and that they need to embrace it and they need to be proud of it.
Just one more thing that in what Bill said, and I totally agree with Bill. We really need to help the grassroots organizations and make contributions to them so they can survive and thrive. And I think that's something that our community has to do, especially the larger organizations in our community. We know who they are, and I think that it's really essential that we support those local organizations when we can. And hopefully going forward that will happen.
Great. How are you? My name is Mark Ember Russo. I have just two areas that I think you'd address. I know it's tough in the schools, but losing and winning some of those battles, but television and film industry. Any time you see something on broadcast where there was an ethnic slur in a movie, or a curse or something like that, or pejorative, it's always bleeped out, except for the word gay. It's always in there. Lesbian, gay, whatever it is, anything else, any other, whatever, N-word, bleeped out. But once it gets to broadcast television, it's the only one that's not bleeped out. So question number one is, do you have any organizational plans to kind of confront that in the industry to say, why are the Italian ethnic slurs always allowed in where all the other ones seem to be edited out? Second question is, I see what you're doing on the legal front. But I remember when Martin Luther King Day came around, I think Arizona said they didn't want to have it. Can you imagine today replacing Martin Luther King Day with Indigenous Peoples Day? So why not lobby? We might need a new, different makeup of Congress, but lobby for a federal Holidays Protection Act to where all federal holidays protected, you won't get federal money, and in that it creates an Indigenous Peoples Day. Can you lobby for this?
I was in Washington last week,
And I can tell you that the Order of the Sons of Italy met with 23 Italian American congressmen. So there is a group, and they're being motivated to help. How much help they're going to give us?
Michael,
let's get political.
Well, I've learned a couple of things about dealing with media, and the First Amendment always comes to mind, but that doesn't mean we just fold our tents and walk away. We've had no success at all with Hollywood. We've had success with Jersey Shore and with The Sopranos. Very little success, but we had some, I would say, accommodations made by those channels in that they gave us some free time to show positive imaging. They also took out the word, the Italian flag from the Jersey Shore. They took out the word cuisine and cuisinette, if I'm pronouncing it properly. In terms of The Sopranos, they added some positive image Italians. I believe the psychiatrist and the FBI agent was Italian. These are little things, but they could have walked away and said, we're not even gonna speak with you because we're making a ton of money and we really don't care. There's no way we're gonna make success with them. We took what we can get. But this really involves more pressure, more pressure, more pressure.
Okay. Just let me touch on that.
This is probably the most conflicting issue that the Italian American community has faced for the past 100 years in this country, is how we address how we feel about the way Italian Americans are portrayed in the media, in particular in media that promotes mafia films and mafia image. And the reason I say that is because if you ask many, many, many Italian Americans what their favorite movie is, Godfather. Why? Because it's great art. It is a great film. Coppola, the greatest art form of the last 100 years, of course, is not sculpture, it's not painting, it's not opera, it's film. And the great Italian American filmmakers, Coppola and Scorsese, are going to be regarded as the Michelangelos of filmmaking 50 and 100 years from now, because they're the great artists in filmmaking. Now, why did they do that? In large part, it was the only door that was open to Italian Americans if they wanted to participate in the film industry and in the television industry. We weren't considered to be intelligent enough or smart enough or creative enough to do anything else. But when it came to making a mafia movie, we were the experts. So Hollywood welcomed them and said, sure, you can make a mafia movie because you lived it. You know what it's all about. So that's how so many of them got their break in the industry. And if you look at all the great Italian-American actors and actresses of who are now in their 50s, 60s, and 70s, all did mafia films at some point in their careers because it was the only vehicle available to them. So I guess the point I'm making is we're very conflicted about this because we don't know how to address this issue. And in my mind, I like to think that the proper thing is balance, and that it's not necessarily wrong to make those kind of movies, especially when they're great art, but we need our share of positive, constructive movies as well, showing us as doctors and important people in society and role models in society so that our children and society has a balanced view of us as a people. But I think we could spend all evening discussing that issue if we wanted to. It's a very compelling issue in our community.
All right, we're going to stop it right here, but I do want to say that if you want to know more about Mother Cabrini, there's a biography written by Pietro Di Donato, which I'm sure none of you know about Mother Cabrini, which Sophia Loren was going to star in the movie, and then her husband absolutely forbade her to be Mother Cabrini in the movie, and so that was canceled out. Also, a lot of these issues, why the gangsters? I wrote a book called From Wise Guys to Wise Men. I don't think anybody's read it, you know, except for some academics and people who gave it good reviews. You know, that explains why the Italians keep getting popped up for that. Anthony Tamburri's book on film explains why. And when we teach these films, we teach something completely different from what just the audience gets. So thank you for attending this town hall meeting.
I'm not going to have the final word, but I just want to mention one other thing that happened this past summer. In the first week in July, the National Education Association voted supposedly to there's 3 million teachers that are part of that organization, and that they voted to do away with Columbus Day and replace it with Indigenous Peoples Day. And that was in the first week, and there was a proclamation made. And I know that we as a community, we've been fighting it, but especially many Alfano, thank you, and One Voice. They've been the leaders in this. And once again, this is once again all of us working together, because I know I promoted it with the organizations I belong to. So these are the kinds of things we have to stick together and to get the right word out there. I'm sorry, but thank you very much.
I would like to thank our sponsors, the people who made it possible for us to have this wonderful fair, this wonderful room, and what we're about to partake right now in terms of refreshments. This needs to continue. This was just the very beginning. We're going to take a look at the video of this. We're going to get it around to some other parts of the country. I'd like to see this happen on Long Island, and I do think someday I want to put a sign up for Italians only and see what happens.